If you would like a copy of the sourdough bread recipe that Brianne follows in this video, we have one that you can download for free from our website. Just go to thebeaglefamily.com, click shop, scroll down, maybe look at a few things, click load more, scroll down a bit more and click the sourdough bread recipe print off at the bottom of the page, then simply click the download button. Hope you enjoy.
We're gonna make sourdough bread!
So the very, very first step and most important step in creating beautiful sourdough bread is making sure that you have a healthy, active starter. This is your yeast. Rather than going to the store and getting dried yeast, you have created your own yeast from the environment of your home by using a very simple slurry of water and flour. Make sure you have good quality filtered water, no chlorine or fluoride, and that you have protein-rich flour, not bleached. If anything, you can use some unbleached, but also make sure there is some whole wheat in there as well so that the starter can feed off of that protein. Rye is one of the best flours to use in your starter in addition to the whole wheat because it is very, very active and will create a very live culture. The flour that I feed our sourdough starter with is a mix of wheat and rye. You must feed your starter every day if you wish to have an active starter to bake with every day. If you do not wish to bake every day, you can simply put your starter in the fridge and reawaken it the day before you plan to bake. So our first step is to activate our starter before we start making bread. I will take out half of the starter that is here from yesterday. Do not discard it because it is very useful to make some really yummy treats later on. Here's about half of it taken out. And as you can see here, there's a collection of starter from the last few days. Now we're going to add equal parts flour and water. You'll also want to smell your starter. Make sure that it has a lovely pungent smell, sour. It should smell sour and somewhat funky. That's a very good thing. And you should see some bubbles in there. It should feel alive and healthy. We add approximately half a cup of our flour and then half a cup of water. And this water is slightly warm right now because I'm just hoping to speed up the process a little bit here. So now we're gonna stir it up. Don't use metal. Use either plastic or wood or glass. Now our sourdough starter is activated. It is not yet ready to make bread with yet. It must grow. I'm going to put this elastic band right at the level where the mix is at right now so we can see how it grows a little bit later. We will soon start to see bubbles and the culture will grow. And remember, your culture is the mirror of what your bread will be later on. If you don't have a healthy, active culture, you will not have healthy, beautiful risen bread. It will be approximately 2 to 4 hours, depending on how warm your kitchen is, before this starter is ready to put into the flour.
Sarah and I take turns grinding and sifting the grain. We use fresh ground flour because it's healthier. We put this bag on so that flour doesn't get all around in the kitchen.
There's a storm across the valley, clouds are rolling in. The afternoon is heavy on your shoulders.
So our next step is called the autolyse. This is a step that many people will skip, but it is vital to the gluten structure of your sourdough bread. All we need is flour and water, and this is the freshly ground flour that Simon just created out in the sifting room. The best time to use your freshly sifted flour is right away because all the nutrients are very fresh. If, however, you cannot use your flour right away, best to store it in the fridge. Our equipment is a scale, measuring cup, wooden spoon, plastic spatula, a plastic bowl. When you're making sourdough bread, it is best to use baker's percentages rather than measuring by volume. It will allow you to have a much more consistent loaf each time. So we'll put our bowl on, set it to zero, and we will be measuring in grams. 800 grams of whole wheat flour. But you could also use rye or a mix of rye. You could also use spelt. 800 grams of flour. 640 grams of water. A couple of little grams, not gonna hurt anything. So we are making 2 loaves of bread today, 100% whole wheat, and we used 800 grams of flour and 640 grams of water. So you simply need just a shaky mass, doesn't need to all be mixed in perfectly. Okay, and we are going to let the dough autolyse for at least 45 minutes, but you could also leave it for 3 hours. Basically, let it sit until your starter is activated. Okay, so it's been approximately 4 hours since we activated our starter and autolysed our bread. First, let's have a look at the starter. All right, so this looks pretty active. We see all the bubbles there. The yeast is doing very, very well. It has almost doubled in size. Actually, about 5 minutes ago, it was slightly higher, and then it just sunk a little bit. It's best to catch your starter when it's at peak activation, where it's completely doubled. So we're a tiny bit late, but our bread will still be good. Okay, so here's a tip if you are wondering if your sourdough starter is good to make bread. Take a little bit, and this is called the float test. Put it in a little bit of water, and if it floats, then you know that you at least have something good to work with. And yes, we do. It's a little bit over the peak activation, but we still have a good starter to use. And this is our autolysed dough. All it is water and flour, and it sat for 4 hours. No yeast at all. Can you imagine how beautiful the gluten test will be later on? So these are both of our ingredients that have sat for 4 hours. And remember, everything in life that is good takes time. Sourdough takes time, but it will also work with your schedule. There was lots of things we could get done during those 4 hours. We just let these things sit and now we're back. People think it takes so long. They're like, well, it does. See, we let the autolyse dough and the starter sit for 4 hours, but I wasn't sitting in the kitchen for 4 hours waiting for it to be ready. You can just do something else. Go do your chores or practice your music or wash your dishes or go play with the horses or something. Okay, when it comes to good things in life taking time, remember, there's sauerkraut, kombucha, cheese, all of these things take time. And so do relationships. We want to have a good relationship with our food too. Okay, now we're ready.
This is called a fermented relationship.
Yes. You want your relationships to also be well fermented. So now we are going to add 120 grams of starter to our dough. So now we do not want to throw all of this out. We need some to save for our next batch of bread, but we also still have a little bit extra. So stay tuned. We'll show you what to do with that later. Next, we add our pink Himalayan salt, about 2% salt, 16 grams for this recipe. Now we mix the starter and the salt together with the dough. When you are mixing dough with your hands, it works really well to have a little bit of water, and you just moisten your hands a little bit and it keeps the dough from sticking. And after this step, we're going to let it rest for another 30 minutes. It usually takes about 2 minutes or so to get the starter and the salt completely incorporated into the dough. And you'll see as we're doing this, it kind of breaks apart quite a bit, but just keep on gently massaging it and it will all get incorporated. And remember, whenever you're working with your dough, you should always feel loving towards it.
If you don't do it with love, they don't turn out lovely.
So now it's kind of sticking a little bit, so just grab a little bit more of your water. And there you go. Now that our salt and our starter is incorporated, we're going to let it sit for 30 minutes. And after that, Sarah is going to spend about 2 hours, possibly 2.5, stretching and folding the dough every 30 minutes. Now, what to do with all the leftover bran and the leftover sourdough starter? Make pancakes. Make sure that you keep this to feed tomorrow morning in prep for your next batch of bread. This is the surplus sourdough starter that we've collected over the last week. You can use this for pancakes, but you could also use it in brownies, biscuits, scallion pancakes, those are really good, bundt cake, anything that you would need a bit of sourdough starter in. And if you're not making anything at all, go feed it to the pigs or the chickens or the compost. This is for Dad's famous Sabbath morning sourdough pancakes. Now, take your bran and pour some in, however much you feel that you would need for your breakfast. So we'll go about this much. Then we're gonna add some water. It's enough water to make a batter-like consistency. And then for tomorrow morning, when Dad actually starts making the pancakes, we can add a little bit more flour if we need, or a little bit more water, depending on how thick we want the batter and how active the starter has been in breaking down all of the protein. You will definitely want to check out our video of Dad making his famous sourdough pancakes. You can check it out in the description box below or up here. What's that?
That's the alarm for the laundry.
Oh man. That's something else you can do while you're waiting for your sourdough to sour. You can do laundry.
Exactly. All right. Simple, simple. Now I'm going to cover this and leave it until tomorrow morning. And then Dad will only have to add eggs, bacon. Okay, you have to check out the video for the rest of the secret ingredients.
Now it's time to stretch and fold. We do it 4 times, one on each side.
There's a truck out on a 4-lane, a mile or more away. The whining of his wheels just makes it colder. He's an hour away from riding on your prayers up.
Then we let it sit for 30 minutes.
10 days on the road.
It has been 2 hours and we have stretched it every 30 minutes. This is our last stretch and fold.
Supper's on the stove. It's the light in your eyes that makes him warm.
We will now allow it to bulk rise for approximately 4 hours in room temperature.
Sometimes this old farm feels like a long lost friend. Yes, and hey, it's good to be back home again.
Our dough has been sitting out for approximately 5.5 to 6 hours, doing its bulk rise. The dough has doubled, almost. Now we're going to just do a little bit of a stretch here, and you can see, look at how lovely. This is very active. Oh my, it's very active. It feels very sticky. So you'll want to just have some water handy. You can take a look here at this beautiful gluten. I'm not gonna stretch it out a whole bunch right now. We wanna just be fairly light with the dough at this point. Fairly gentle. Okay. And the sesame seeds are optional. They add a really nutty taste though, and we love it. whole wheat will ripen much faster than unbleached, particularly if you have bran in it. The bran provides a lot of food for the culture and really speeds up the fermentation process. This flour is very protein rich. Okay, so just don't work it too much. And put some, and you would be able to roll your dough in a little bit of flour. That's nice too. The sesame seeds are our family favorite though. So you see it is getting flat. It's almost over fermenting. We could have done this a little bit sooner. So we're gonna just let it sit here for a few minutes and then we're going to score it and put it in the hot oven at 450 degrees. Another important tip for making beautiful sourdough bread is to make sure that you bake your bread in a steamy oven. Steamy oven equals amazing bread. It allows for the first 5 to 10 minutes the crust of the bread to remain moist so that the bread can rise and expand to its full potential before hardening off. And that thick, rustic crust that we all love about sourdough. What we're gonna do is take a pan and put it in the bottom of the oven 5 minutes prior to baking so that the pan can get very hot, and then all we do is pour a bit of water in and that will create the steam in our oven. Most people do not cook their bread long enough or hot enough. Definitely do not cook your bread any lower than 250. You're probably wondering, is my bread ready to bake? Here's a way to check. It's called the poke test. Just take your finger and poke very gently, and your bread should spring back slightly. If there is no spring back at all, you have probably overproofed your bread. But if it springs back completely, then your bread needs to proof a little bit longer right where it's at. So this came back slightly. So it looked, and it still has a bit of an indent. So that's what we want. And this one, you can poke that. And it's springing back slightly. So
perfect.
The bread is ready to now score. The reason why you want to score your bread is to allow the yeast and the gases to have a place to go so that it won't find its own place to go. This is basically the baker's signature. In the old days, when there was a central oven in the village, all the bakers would have their own signature for their loaf, so everyone would know whose loaf was whose. You can just, to have fun, make sure that you cut deep enough all the way down. You can use a razor blade. This is a serrated Cutco. It works just as well. There we go. We'll come back in about 20 minutes and see how it's making out. Once your bread is fully cooked, you want to keep it in your oven for 20 more minutes, but turn the oven off so that the crust has time to caramelize. So everybody likes to eat fresh baked bread while it's still warm. One thing to remember though is that if you cut into your loaf while it's still warm and you do not finish the entire loaf, it will get gummy and sticky. So either don't eat it at all or eat all of it. We're going to save one for tomorrow and we're going to have a party and eat one tonight. Do we go to bed?
I'll take that.
We should make a
balsamic.
Yep.
Balsamic.
We're gonna make a really quick balsamic vinegar olive oil dip for the bread.
We take some olive oil. This was from our dream cheese. Some apple cider vinegar.
It's another quirky big old recipe.
And some dill. Thank you. And some balsamic vinegar. Balsamic vinegar is so good. And our own garlic powder. Lots of that. Yum. And a whole bunch of dried kale and Swiss chard leaves. That's really good. Parsley. Some salt. Oh, and pepper is really, really good. Although the pepper from our Belpernil cheese works absolutely awesome. I gotta get to that bread before it's all gone.
Uh-oh, it's almost gone.
Yep. Oh.
Mm-hmm. I gotta get my hands on this before it's all gone.
You better.
Now it's time to feed the starter.
So make sure that you restart your sourdough starter every day if you would like a fresh culture to work with. If you would not like to bake every day, then you can just simply put this in the fridge and restart it the night before the day you plan to bake.
And that's all you need to make sourdough bread.
Flour,
water,
salt,
thyme, and love. This starter has neither, but instead throwing it out or I'll try that again. You do not want just protein rich flour. This is the step that will kickstart the And this takes a little while. You just have to, This will be what you feel.
I was afraid that would happen. It always happens like that.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. Be sure to check out the video on sourdough pancakes. Dad's sourdough pancake.
It's been 2 hours and we have stretched and folded it every 30 hours.
Not 30 hours.
Oh no!
Okay, go ahead, do it again.
It has been two.
Oh no.
Sorry.
It is fully cooked and it doesn't look gummy at all. Oh man. Once your bread is fully cooked.
Look at this beautiful room.
Kind of messy.
Aww.
Hey, these are nice boxes.
Yeah. Look at all these beautiful plants Sunny's been working on. And Mom.
Gotta clean this up in here.
Yeah. Maybe we shouldn't video. It's not that messy at all.